Now, we will start with an important branch of stereochemistry, that is optical isomerism. Before we know what is optical isomerism, we should understand what is optical activity. I mean, all of you, please stop your videos here. I can't do only this job. Keep blocking your videos. I'm not understanding why you don't do the simple thing. Fine. The optical activity is something connected to optics. Is it not? As the name itself tells, there is optics in the optical activity. So optics means something connected to light. Is it not? In fact, you know, even the eye specialists, the doctors who take care of the eyes are called ophthalmologists. So optics is concerned to light. Now, how is this light, the branch of optics, connected to our organic compounds? That is what we are going to see now. There is one phenomenon in optics called polarization of light. So we will understand a bit about the polarized light before we connect that polarized light to our organic compounds. So what do you mean by polarization of light? First of all, what is light? You know, a light is best described as an oscillating oscillation in space. In fact, therefore, you can represent a light wave in the form of a sinusoidal wave. So this is what I have done. If you see the oscillations, what is this picture tells? It simply tells the oscillation of the electromagnetic field. In fact, propagating light is nothing but an electromagnetic wave. Is it not? Fine. So you can represent the oscillation through a sinusoidal wave like this. So let me track a sinusoidal wave. This one, this is a sinusoidal wave. Okay. But the lights, when it is traveling in space, the vibrations are not confined to a single plane, what we are showing. Whenever we represent a wave, we will just write a sinusoidal wave like this. Is it not? Sinusoidal wave like this. But that doesn't mean the light is traveling only on that plane. In fact, the light is traveling in the space on all possible planes available around a 360 degree sphere. Okay, so if, for example, you take a sphere, and how many planes you can cut inside that sphere, how many planes you can cut, or how many planes you can identify inside that sphere? Infinite, basically. Is it not? You can have infinite planes in that sphere. So now let us consider the space as a sphere. Now the wave is traveling, electromagnetic light wave is traveling. It can travel as a sinusoidal wave on one plane of that sphere. Another wave of light is traveling on the other plane. So, in fact, you go on constructing all the planes the light wave can travel. You will end up in constructing a sphere, is it not? So this is called unpolarized light. Unpolarized light means a light whose oscillations are not confined to a plane. In fact, whose oscillations take place on all possible planes in the direction of its propagation. That is what unpolarized light is. In fact, this is also called an ordinary light. Unpolarized light is called an ordinary light. Now, what do we mean by polarization of the light? Polarization of light means simply, we have to confine the light which is traveling in all directions, or whose oscillations are there on planes oriented in all directions. We have to confine this light to a single plane oscillation. So the light has to oscillate on a single plane. So can we do something like this, basically? So you can see unpolarized light, ordinary light here. I have done something. Let us discuss about this polaroid later. I'm then getting out a light whose oscillation are there in one plane. That's it. This is the plane of oscillation. So this is the polarized light. So how to polarize the light now? How to convert this ordinary light or the unpolarized light into a polarized light? This is the question. We can do this. In fact, light gets polarized naturally also. Okay, we have light coming from cosmic source, from skies, which part of the light is polarized. But now, how can we do it? We can do it using an optical instrument or optical object called a polarizer, which is also referred to as a Polaroid. What does a Polaroid contain? In fact, there is a optical material called Nicol prism. Okay, and in fact, I don't have the picture of it. Nicol prism, NICOLPRISM, Nicol prism. What does this Nicol prism contain? This Nicol prism is made up of two pieces, which are joined together through a narrow slit, very miniature narrow slit. And the rest of the prism, except this narrow slit, is opaque to light. Hope you understand what is opaque to light. It doesn't allow light to pass through the rest of its body, except through this narrow prism. So what can happen if the unpolarized light is passed through that? Simply, the planes, which are the plane of the light, which is coinciding or which is parallel to the slit of the Nicol prism, only that plane passes through. Is it not? All the other planes are rejected because the prism is opaque. Only in this direction it is transparent to light. So the light passes through the slit and comes out as a polarized light. Okay, fine. So this is how we can polarize a light. I mean, this is what I have represented. You see the unpolarized light here? I mean, this shows the polarization process better than this, isn't it? The light waves, which are oscillating in all possible planes in all directions. And there is a polarizer, which is also sometimes called polarizing filter. Nicol prism is one of the examples of polarizer. There are many polarizers. Now, this polarizer allows only light whose plane of oscillation matches with its own slit plane. So the light coming out of that is now confined to a single plane in the space. Therefore, this is called the polarized light. These are now the cartoons, the pictures which show you the polarization and unpolarized light converted to polarized. But how to represent it symbolically? Unpolarized light is represented like this. So you can, what is this? This is simply the cross section of the sphere of propagation. You can see the light is now oscillating in all directions. In all possible directions. In fact, I have just shown you four planes. It's not four planes. There are infinite planes like this on which the light oscillates. And a plane polarized light is now represented like this. Okay. With single lines like this. This is called a plane polarized light. So basically, what have we done? The unpolarized light here. What is the difference in this diagram? The wave is not represented. The light is not represented in the form of a wave. Rather, using the symbol of unpolarized light. This is the source, a bulb, which gives out unpolarized light. In fact, all the light comes out of your bulbs. Test tube, tube lights, LEDs, LCDs. They're all unpolarized. You pass it through a Nicol prism or a polarizer. And you get a plane polarized light. Okay. Now, that is fine. What happens if I put one more polarizer in the direction of plane polarized light? This is the question. This is an interesting question, is it not? As you see here, the slit of this polarizer is in this parallel direction. Let it be a vertical line, which represents the slit of this polarizer. So when the light goes through this, this is the plane. So where is the plane now, which is parallel to this slit? Is it not parallel to this slit? Now I will put one more polarizer, and the slit of that I bring perpendicular to the slit of the first polarizer. So what is the relative arrangement of two slits, polarizer one and polarizer two? They are perpendicular to each other, is it not? Now you tell me, what happens to light? What happens to light? Okay, what happens to light? Does it pass through this slit? I mean, somebody can answer this. Somebody can answer. What happens to this light? Why? No one is answering. Is there a problem with connection? No, I think. Anyways, so the light doesn't pass through. Is it not? Because the slits are perpendicular to each other. Therefore, no light comes out. Okay. Now, if I have to make the light come back, I have to restore the intensity of the light. What should I do? I should rotate this slit so that the slit aligns again parallel to this first polarizer. In that case, the plane polarized light passes through the slit and comes out. Okay. In fact, when I told the light doesn't come out or the light comes out, how do you detect it practically? It is on the detection of the intensity of the light. Is it not? So what is the relationship between the intensity and the angle by which you can rotate this? So intensity of the light here means what? After the second polarizer is related to the intensity here, I naught intensity, as cos square theta, and theta is the angle by which you rotate the slits. Okay, fine. So if the theta is zero, that means what? When both the slits are parallel to each other, then you get I is equal to I naught. So you get maximum intensity. If theta is 90 degree, you get zero intensity. Okay, so this is how a polarized light is analyzed. Okay, what do you mean by this statement? A polarized light is analyzed. It simply means that you can analyze whether the light is polarized or not by passing through a nickel prism, by passing through a polarizer again. If it is unpolarized, let us think if it is unpolarized, then what happens? There is no fall in intensity. Because in any direction, the slit is coinciding with the plane of the light. Only if the light is polarized, the intensity falls. In fact, the intensity reaches zero for the perpendicular position of the slit. For the parallel position of the slit, the intensity is maximum. In between parallel and perpendicular positions, the intensity from, if you go to perpendicular to parallel, the intensity slowly increases and reaches maximum. From parallel to perpendicular position, the intensity from maximum slowly falls to zero. Is it not? So this is called waxing and waning of the intensity as you rotate the analyzer. So what is the thing what we have learned now? You can plane polarize a light using a polarizer. You can analyze the polarized light using a second polarizer, which is also called analyzer. And now there is a relationship between the intensity of light coming out of the second analyzer or the second polarizer and the angle by which you rotate the analyzer. Is it not? Okay. So this is plane optics. Till now, we haven't dealt anything about the organic compounds optical activity. This is only simple basic physics of optics, where how to polarize a light and what are the essentials of a polarized light. That is what we have done. Okay, now we'll move on to this light. Same thing what I told. You have unpolarized light passing through a polarizer. You make it plane polarized. This is called plane polarized light, not just polarized light, plane polarized light. When it passes through a second polarizer, which is also called an analyzer. This is the polarizer, this is the analyzer. Analyzer is also a polarizer, but based on its function, we have called it analyzer. And then the light comes out. And the intensity of the light which is coming out is related to the angle of dihedral angle. In fact, the angle of these two slits, is it not? If they are parallel, intensity is maximum. If they are perpendicular, intensity is zero. In between angles, the intensity is in between. Okay, fine. Now, what we will do now is, we'll do something bit peculiar. What is that? You have a polarized light here. Now the polarized light is directly going to the analyzer. Okay, fine. Now let us keep our organic compounds solution in between polarized light and analyzer. Or simply, we will have a solution of organic compound in between polarizer and analyzer. Okay. And then analyze the intensity of the light here. If you do this, you require an instrument. And that instrument is called a polarimeter. What is a polarimeter? Polarimeter is not just meant for polarizing the light. Please understand this. It is also meant for analyzing the polarized light, plane of plane polarized light. So what are the essential components of a polarimeter? Should have a light source, which gives out your unpolarized light, and then polarizer, which plane polarizes the light, and the plane polarized light passes through the sample tube. What does the sample tube contains? Organic compounds solution, solution of organic compounds, sample tube contains. And then you have a analyzer, which again has a slit, of course. It is also a polarizer, but now it's called analyzer, to which is attached a compass to measure the angle, degrees, almost a protractor pattern. A compass is attached. Okay, fine. Now, what is that we have to do? We have to initially, let us keep the polarizer and analyzer in parallel position. Polarizer and analyzer in parallel position. In the sample tube, let there be nothing. So only air is there in the sample tube. Now I'm going to ask you a question. If you have understood this, please answer. And I will switch on the bulb. What is the intensity of the light detected? What is the intensity of the light detected? Okay. Can I answer this? What is the intensity of the light detected? Hello?
Less intense.
What? What? Somebody answer. You just look at the relative positions of this slit, the angle between these two slits.
Zero.
Huh? Hello? Hello? This slit and a slit here, they are in parallel positions, yeah. And there is nothing in a sample tube. What is the intensity detected here?
So maximum intensity.
Maximum intensity. Because the light is coming. Yes, yes, correct. Because the plane polarized light is which is coming out is simply just passing through the prism. Is it not? Without so maximum intensity is detected. Now, what I will do is the optical activity concept starts from here, actually. I hope you have understood the construction of a polarimeter, the basic construction of a polarimeter. Of course, polarimeter is a device whose constructions you need not have to know fully. The basic components of polarimeter. So in this sample tube, I had air. Now I will fill up water here. Water. What happens to the intensity here? This is the question. The slits are again parallel to each other. The slits are parallel. I am not changing the positions of the slits. I am just changing the compounds in the tube, sample tube. What is the intensity here? What is the intensity? Hello? Hello?
So it depends on how water is like.
It depends on how water? How water? Okay, fine. I will answer this question myself. If you have water in this, plain water, there is no fall in the intensity again. You will get maximum intensity. You have another sample, example, ethyl alcohol. You get maximum intensity. Fine. So, go on changing compounds. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. There is some problem with my connectivity. So please don't mind. I'll continue now. Okay. Fine. So what happens to the intensity? If I use plain water here, as I told you, the intensity is still maximum. Now, if I use ethyl alcohol, the intensity is maximum. But if I use, for example, glucose solution inside this, okay, glucose solution inside this, then what happens? The intensity is not maximum. The intensity would have decreased. The intensity would have reduced. For the parallel positions of the slits, the intensity would have reduced. Okay, so what can I do now? I can now search for an angle, or simply I will do this. I will rotate my analyzer by some degree. Rotate my analyzer. And in this whole rotation of about 90 degree, yeah? Only 90 degree I'm going to rotate. And see whether the intensity comes back again to maximum for some rotation of the analyzer. It happens, so happens that the intensity is restored to maximum if I rotate this by some angle. So what does this mean? What does this mean? Am I audible? Yeah, what does this mean? So what is my question? The intensity, if I fill glucose inside my polarimeter tube, sample tube, is not maximum for the slits in parallel positions. But if I rotate it by some angle within 90 degree, I'm going to get my intensity back to maximum. So what does this mean? This has not happened with water. This has not happened with ethyl alcohol. This has not happened with urea solutions. This has not happened with sodium chloride solution. This has happened with glucose. So what is this P? What does this mean? Someone can answer this.
Hello? Glucose lightener rotate mat.
Madir bahudu, is it not? See,
yes,
one thing is sure.
Isomerism. Isomerism. Glutoise.
No, not to do isomerism. One thing is sure. What is sure? I can get the intensity maximum. I can get the maximum intensity only when the condition is satisfied. What is that condition? The slit of the analyzer should be in parallel position to the plane of plane polarized light. Now you see, before it is going through the sample tube, the plane of plane polarized light is vertical like this. Is it not? Once it goes into the sample tube and comes out, due to some reason, let us see what is the reason later. Due to some reason, the plane of plane polarized light has got bent. Is it not? It was vertical before going through the tube. Now it has become a slant plane. Is it not? Now it has, the plane is slant now. If I keep my analyzer in the vertical position, what happens? The maximum intensity is not obtained. When is the maximum intensity obtained? When my analyzer's slit matches with this slant direction. Is it not? But the plane of plane polarized light was not like this before going through the tube. After going through the tube, the direction changed, the plane changed. So what does this mean? This means there is some interaction going on inside the tube, which is rotating the plane of plane polarized light. Which is rotating the plane of plane polarized light. Okay. What is the angle of rotation that you can determine by rotating our analyzer? Is it not? So if you rotate the analyzer, by what angle has the plane of plane polarized light been rotated? By the compound in the tube, that we can determine. And this angle is called optical rotation. Okay. So for the first time, we are seeing the word optical rotation. Okay. So now you can simply go on classifying the compounds into two groups. One group optically inactive, that means water, ethyl alcohol, urea, NaCl, all these solutions I told, which do not rotate the plane of plane polarized light. They are optically inactive. Second group of compounds are optically active compounds. What are these optically active compounds? Which rotate the plane of plane polarized light. Okay, that is what optically active compound mean. Okay, all of you send your names in the chat box. Send your names in the chat box. I will continue with the lecture because I see the lecture will end in 8 minutes as the timer is showing. Anyways, so that is what optical rotation means. So now the optical rotation, of course, is determined by many factors. It is not just the compound itself. Of course, the first factor is the compound itself, nature of the compound, concentration of the solution, length of the polarimeter tube, and the wavelength of the incident radiation. Okay, wavelength of this radiation, wavelength of the polarized radiation. This is the, what is the wavelength at which I am getting the radiation? All these factors determine what is the angle of rotation. The angle of rotation is expressed as alpha. But as with all other constants, since alpha is dependent on so many factors, I just have to normalize these factors. How do I normalize these factors? By dividing the observed rotation value with concentration and length of the tube. See this? Because concentration and length of the tube are parameters, are variables. So if I divide by length and concentration of the sample, length of the tube and concentration of the sample, the alpha I'm going to convert into specific activity. simply you see this, just alpha is an observed activity. What do you mean by activity? Observed angle of rotation. Specific activity is alpha divided by length into concentration, where L is the length of the polarimeter tube in decimeters. C is the concentration of the sample. And as I've enlisted, temperature of the sample also has an effect. So on specific activity term, you should mention at what temperature you have recorded the optical activity, and also mention at what wavelength you have recorded the optical activity. Fine. So these are the parameters that have to be specified to convert observed activity alpha into specific activity, which is specific activity is alpha enclosed inside a parenthesis. This is called alpha inside a square bracket. Okay. So this is what specific activity means. Now let us look at the specific activities of some common organic compounds, natural compounds, particularly cholesterol, cocaine, morphine. And you see that morphine has a specific activity is 132 degree. You look at oxacillin, it has a specific activity of 201 degree. How is it possible? Yeah? Because you can rotate your analyzer only by 180 degree, for example, or even by 90 degree. In fact, 90 degree rotation is allowed. 90 degree rotation is allowed. How is it possible 201 degree can come? What's your answer? Hello? Because this is specific activity, not observed activity. Observed angle of rotation cannot be plus 90 degree or cannot be more than plus 90 degree and minus 90 degree. This is specific activity, because in the denominator here, in the denominator, you would divide this 90 degree, maximum 90 degree by some values, right? L into C. So naturally, the whole answer could be more than 90 degree. Sometime it can be in thousands. Specific activity can be 1000 degree. It doesn't mean you can rotate your analyzer by 1000 degree. Impossible. But the analyzer's angle of rotation, you are converted into specific activity by dividing by two terms, the length of the tube and concentration. Of course, with a given polarimeter, the length is not a factor. Concentration is a factor. Different concentrations of glucose gives different observed activity. Now, how I have to convert it to a physical constant of specific activity? Like specific activity, specific rotation is like a physical constant, like melting point, refractive index, boiling points, density, such things. They are physical constants, specific and activities are. So for the given compound, there is a single value of specific activity. But observed activity can be anything, depends on the concentration of the compound solution. Specific activity is fixed. It has a single value, fine. Therefore, it is called a physical constant of that compound. Fine. There is a, nowadays, the new term is coined for specific activity. Instead of specific rotation, we call it molecular rotation. What is this molecular rotation? Simply, the specific rotation value, you multiply by its molecular weight and divide by 100. Molecular weight of the compound, okay, and divide by 100. So that will give you molecular rotation. Do you understand? So which are the three practical parameters we learnt? Specific, observed rotation. What is observed rotation? Is nothing but the angle by which you have to rotate the analyzer to get back the maximum intensity of the plane polarized light. That is the angle. That is the observed rotation. Observed rotation, you can convert into specific rotation using this formula. Specific rotation, you can convert into molecular rotation using this formula. Is it not? So these are the three parameters associated with the optical activity of the compounds. Okay, fine. So I will stop here. Next class, we will take up optical isomerism. Till now, today we discussed only about optical activity. Next, optical isomerism. Okay. So.